thank you to the January 2020 Patreon supporters of the What We Remember podcast. Jacqueline M., Matthew J., Nathan E., Paul and Sandy J., Stephanie O., and Big Time Jim. Help support the show and get your name read at the beginning of all of our episodes. Patreon.com/WhatWeRemember. Thanks.
Man, what a movie.
And speaking of movies, this is a podcast about movies.
Oh, yeah.
We do?
Sometimes.
Sometimes?
I think so.
Do you know that we've been doing a podcast?
What is a podcast?
Oh, geez. Oh, well, this is actually kind of hard to explain. So,
yeah.
People sit in a room and usually talk about something.
They,
usually more important than whatever we talk about.
Yeah, and they like to think that it's very profound, but mm-hmm. it's usually just something no one cares.
They're talking about podcast.
Yeah. Oh, podcast. Yeah. I guess you're right. We would be talking about podcasts.
Oh.
And it's usually about true crime. And,
of course.
Or it's about like a specific moment in history with an expert about it.
Mm-hmm. Or it's like famous people talking about
pop
culture.
Yeah, it's like a celebrity talking about something. Mm-hmm. That's kind of. And then it's on the internet. They put it onto the internet.
What is the internet?
Oh, wow. Al Gore, in 1992, had this idea
for
to steal...
a series of tubes.
steal this thing that already existed in the 80s.
The DARPANET.
Claim it for himself.
Andy, we just watched Hackers. They explained all of this to you.
What is Hackers?
My name is Riley Jones.
My name is Andrew Moldenhauer.
And I'm Andy Hubert.
And this is not a movie review podcast, but a podcast where we try to remember what happened in a movie that we haven't seen in a very, very long time. And this is a first for the show. We're doing a documentary, and this is what we remember about Super Size Me?
Were there two or three bad guys in Home Alone? And who was that forgetful fish in Finding Nemo? Join us as we're watching films. See what we remember and what memories we kill. Let's start the show. Here we go. This is what we remember.
Super Size Me?
Is there a question mark in the title?
So we were thinking,
We were thinking.
What's a documentary people have seen that also has sort of a narrative? Andy hadn't seen March of the Penguins.
I've heard that they march.
Planet Earth?
The whole documentary.
Kind of a
television
show? It's kind of a narrative, though.
Everything else is kind of sad, like Bowling for
Columbine. Bowling for Columbine is the only other one I can think of. Yeah, that's a heavy,
bummer of a movie. Yeah. But I think like documentaries had sort of a renaissance in the early 2000s, beginning with Bowling for Columbine. People like went out to the theaters to like see these things.
Yeah.
Art theaters were kind of like popping up and making a thing.
It's kind of weird. There was like early 2000s had sort of an explosion of theatrical documentaries, but then they like died for a while.
They did.
And they kind of came back with like Netflix, essentially. Mm-hmm. Netflix was able to throw them all up into a place where they could easily be seen and actually buy up, you know, distribution for
people want to see these movies. They just don't want to go to the theaters and see them, I guess. I guess Mr. Rogers is the one most recent exception. Well, Once You've Been My Neighbor was a pretty well-released documentary.
There's been a couple more of them.
Yeah, the RBG was in there.
Yeah, that's true.
That was in the theater for quite some time.
Oh, really?
Yep.
What else was out in the theater?
But yeah, I mean, I think all the ones we've currently seen, I think, are sort of part of that post-streaming revolution, because that really did kind of bring documentaries back, I feel like.
When we watch the Oscars every year, almost all of those are like Netflix documentaries.
They are.
Because there's
a market for them.
Every year, like, I try to watch as many of the Oscar films as I can ahead of time, and the documentaries used to be impossible to find. You couldn't watch them even if you wanted to. There was no way to see them.
And now they're all about Syria.
Now you can actually find them on most of those sites. Yeah.
Well, they're about a lot of stuff, depending on what you're looking for.
Yeah. Now it's so much easier to actually get access to that stuff, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, because now it makes a market for it, where documentaries didn't quite have the same appeal.
Yeah, and they cover important and interesting stuff. Like, I mean, I just watched, was it 2 years ago? Icarus, which won, I think, for Best Documentary.
That's
the doping
scandal. I'm trying to think of that guy's name, and it just fell out of my head. The Biker Man.
Yeah. Well,
Peter Biker Man.
Peter Biker Man.
Strong.
No, it was about the 2000.
Live Strong.
2014 Sochi rushing doping scandal.
The documentary was originally about doping in cycling, and it blew open the scandal about the Olympic doping. Mm. Yes. And that documentary is one that's really funny because
Lance Armstrong. Like
the first,
not about him.
I got there. Yeah,
the first half of that
was about biking.
The first half of that documentary is the documentary the dude set out to make, and it's bad. And then the second half is the part that accidentally happened, and that's the part that's amazing and incredible.
And that's a good point, because I do remember watching half of it, and I was like, I don't understand why it's so good.
Because <Yeah. laughs>
then I had to come back to it like after it won, and I was like, okay, let me watch the rest of it.
He's like, I trained so hard, and last year I came in fifth, and so I'm going to dope for the entire year, see if I can beat the system and see where I place. And then he places in like 20th the next year while doping, and he's just like, if that had been his whole documentary, it'd have been like, great job wasting a lot of other people's money on your documentary.
Yeah, I would have been like, I've seen this before, it's called Supersize Me.
Instead, he manages to link up with the Russian dude in charge of all the dope scandals.
Yeah, if it's like a live, like they're making the documentary that's going on and anything could happen. I mean, like, that's what's crazy about documentaries. If you're doing something like a music group or just like some, like, telling about a time, like documentary wise, I mean, it's you can't write the narrative as it's going because it's already been written. I remember watching My Kid Could Paint That, that came out a few years ago.
That's a good one.
It's about a little girl who was just doing this amazing, like, abstract art, but for whatever reason, whenever the camera was on it, she just couldn't do it.
Hmm.
And there's a scene in the where the documentary is like talking to the dad. It's like, what kind of a documentary am I making here? Is it like she really doing it, or is or is this like you doing it for her? Like, what story are we trying to tell here? And it's like, gets more complicated. He didn't think that was going to be the story going in. He thought it was going to be shooting a documentary about a kid who paints.
Yeah.
It was built on a perfect lie.
And it changed otherwise.
And the documentary is like, okay, this lie is going to come forth.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's hard to say whether that kid was really painting or not. It's like, she ended up doing paintings like later in life.
She's not.
And like, she grew up to do it. Yeah. Yeah, well, I think like her dad was just like telling her where to do and what colors to use mostly. I don't think he actually ever
Mom was painting the entire time.
I don't think anyone but her put, you know, actual paint on the thing, but she for whatever reason like wouldn't work with the cameras on. The dad like couldn't get the same result out of her. Hard to say.
Yeah, it sounds like someone else is painting those.
I don't know. Like if you're holding the brush, but I'm telling you what to do and what to use, it's like who's painting the picture?
Yeah, that's true. That's kind of it's kind of a neat philosophical question about the nature of the art.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
But you also got to you got to see if what he's saying is actually truthful.
Mm.
Yeah.
If that's his, yeah, I'm telling her what to paint. Yeah, that's what's happening.
But Supersize Me. Morgan Spurlock.
Morgan Spurlock.
I think he maybe did documentaries before this one. This is definitely his big one.
Yeah.
Came out in the theaters.
I think this was like what he was... This made his name...
Without a doubt.
For sure. This was his big break.
I don't know if he was making...
I think he was working on movies before this, like actual films. As like an art department or something like that.
Okay.
And why this was so sensational at the time is because, like, everyone knew McDonald's was bad for us, but we kept eating it anyway. Didn't really matter. It was the height of, like, the Supersize Me, the documentary.
Mm-hmm.
Things were getting bigger and bigger. The obesity epidemic was, like, raging in America. Yes. It's where it started. So the documentary's premise is that he, for 30 days, will eat nothing but McDonald's for breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
And he always has to supersize it if they ask him if he wants to supersize it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was built on the idea that McDonald's tried to say that their food was actually not going to make you fat. There was something that they said around that time that made him go, okay, well, let me try that. Let me challenge that. Because I think a court case just came out, I believe is what happened, that said it was a girl that was suing McDonald's for making her fat. And then McDonald's was like, our food is not what made you fat.
Hmm.
It was the fact that you were overeating or something like that. They were basically saying, no, it was you the entire time. So he's like, okay.
Yeah.
Well, let me try and see if I can prove that McDonald's makes me fat.
Right.
He gets a bunch of blood tests and makes sure like his like vitals, they have a baseline of like how he is. And, you know, he's like a healthy guy. He's like, he says he eats McDonald's every once in a while.
And this was supposed to be, it's like every day for a month he was going to do this?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Breakfast, lunch, and dinner he was going to have. But he also like goes out of his way, I feel, some of the time to eat like specifically like the bad things.
Yeah, no, he said he was going to go through every single item on the menu.
He does eat the entire menu.
Yeah.
But, I mean, in 30 days, you're going to get some repeats to happen.
Yep. Absolutely.
And, like...
Because he gets to that, like, fish.
Yeah.
And he, like, throws it up. there's like, a fish sandwich.
Yeah, so the fun part of the movie is, like, he likes it, like, the first week or so, but then it, like, literally starts to kill him.
Because it's the same shit over and over. It's, like, carbs and sugar and salt and... It's just like empty calories and bad
and
food.
You just like like see him.
It's all processed.
Get worse.
Well, and because he is supersizing, like I mean, yeah, McDonald's isn't great for you, but like if you're eating that much of anything that many times, I feel like you're gonna not feel great.
Right. He's just eating too much food in general.
Yes, but at the same time, it, man, and it's sort of like a you can't look away kind of documentary where you're watching this man just like wreck himself.
It's someone going to the extreme of something.
Yeah, yeah. You get to like watch like his pain and you're like, oh man, what a crazy dude. Well,
I would never
what's going to happen
30
next?
Days at McDonald's,
oh, brutal.
Yeah.
Ooh, man.
But I will say, I remember people saying it and I was thinking it too when that movie was over. Man, I want some McDonald's. That food looked good. Does anyone else want McDonald's?
McDonald's is like great advertisement.
The cover of that documentary with him and the fries in his mouth, I'm always like, I could go for some fries.
Yeah. He's also got that he's got that American chopper.
The handlebars.
Handlebar mustache.
Yeah, he does.
That you see in like the OC Chopper show.
Yep.
Oh. He looks like he fit right in with those guys.
American Chopper.
American Chopper.
I do remember his girlfriend, or wife, I think it was his girlfriend.
One or the other.
Yeah. They ended up getting married, and then they got divorced. But she's a vegan, and she's a chef, too.
Okay.
Yeah, so she's
that
like...
That must not have been a fun day, month for her.
I don't think so. I don't...
I think there's a moment where she tries to, like, feed him broccoli or something, and he's like, broccoli isn't served at McDonald's, so I can't eat the broccoli.
You knew what this was when you got into this relationship.
I'm a McDonald's man now. He's also, I'm just like throwing.
Trying to remember things.
I'm throwing
coming
random
out of
things
the
out there. He also like tries to figure out like, well, what are the calories of the items?
Yeah,
and then he like asks like a bunch of people at McDonald's like, where are your like nutrition facts? Because they have to post that. You're like required to post
they're, like,
that.
Hidden, yeah.
They're like
document
behind
somewhere.
They're behind a cardboard cutout of Ronald McDonald. It was like behind that, like no one can find it for quite some time. They're like, oh, this is where it is. It's covered up.
This
movie
definitely brought that to light within like the fast food industry in general.
Yeah.
Calories started to show up next to the food items.
Yeah.
Information became like more obvious online of what was actually in your food.
And I do, and a lot of the chains really did make an effort, I think, to include not necessarily healthier, but what looked to be like healthier alternatives on their menus.
Mm-hmm.
Like there was jokes coming afterwards, like because McDonald's incorporated, like introduced like a whole line of salads into their menu.
But their salads,
but
are
they
so
have
bad.
A lot of them have as many or more calories than some of their regular hamburger meals.
You put any dressing in there.
The dressing they use is just insanely huge in calories.
Yeah, I think a Big Mac is less calories than one of their salads.
Yeah, it
was.
Is. But yeah, you're right. It was kind of like this, the beginning of that push for some of these chains, and I think those spurring people to eat healthier in general force their hand anyway, because you know those people are going to eat less unless they give them an option for that.
And it's happening again with the Impossible Burger at Burger King. It's like one of the best selling items like in fast food history right now.
Something just
it's
came out
it.
Too that said not any better for you.
Probably not. It's better, probably the same calories.
Better for the planet though. reduce our
better,
reliance
yes,
on beef.
It did.
Which
it
would
did
be
say
bad.
That exact thing. It said better for the planet, not better for your nutrition.
Yes,
I would believe that. Yeah.
Yep.
We're not there yet.
Yeah.
You still have to eat real food, people.
Well, yeah.
But I want a Whopper, Andy.
Burger King.
I want a Big Mac, like that guy who ate a Big Mac every day for his like entire life that shows up in the movie.
Oh, he does show up in the movie.
And Morgan Spurlock meets that guy. He just recently had his like 10,000th or 100,000th Big Mac. It was like a big deal.
We should look up if that guy is dead.
No, he's still alive.
What?
I think he's still alive.
He was skinny too.
Yeah, he was just the skinny.
He was
fat
like,
guy.
I eat 3 Big Macs a day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I was like, dude, you are dead.
I like this Big Mac guy. He's like the poster boy from McDonald's.
There's actually not as many calories in a Big Mac as I would have expected.
It's not that bad.
Because that came up at Pub Trivia once even. It could like, you know,
you take that bread out of there and you got yourself a good meal.
Yeah, you had to guess how many calories were in like a Big Mac combo.
The problem with eating the Big Mac though is it's so big and the center just falls out.
It does.
It
like
keep eating it.
It all starts to like come out the back.
You're squishing it.
Yeah.
You're squishing
it's a problematic
the center
sandwich.
Out.
It's a messy burger.
Yeah, they need to have it in like the In-N-Out style where it's like wrapped up.
It doesn't help also that they use like the shredded lettuce, so that stuff just gets everywhere. Mm-hmm. Like as soon as you pick that burger up, you get lettuce all over.
There's no like tomatoes on that thing either.
Can I tell you, I still remember the moment I had my first Big Mac.
Same here.
Dude, I do. What? Dude, that burger's delicious. I love a Big Mac.
That's like a milestone in a kid's life when they transition from a cheeseburger to the Big Mac.
I finally had like an actual Big Mac, because like that's like the signature burger.
Let's go around the room and tell our Big Mac stories real quick. You go ahead, Andy.
Well, mine I remember because it actually coincided with the surgery that I had when I was younger.
Mm-hmm.
So I like had the surgery done, and then I had told, I think my grandma or my mom, I had like a couple people with me. I was like, we are going to McDonald's and I'm going to have a Big Mac after this surgery.
Yeah. Were you like six or 7 years old?
I think I was like maybe, I was in third grade, I think.
Okay.
Whatever age that would be.
You would be probably eight.
Okay. So I was like, we're going to do this after we get done. And they were like, yes, we're going to do that. Sounds great. And I got to sit down, order it myself, eat the whole thing with all the, what does it have, like Thousand Island stuff just like dripping out. Yeah, you can't even eat, like an 8-year-old trying to eat a Big Mac. Come on.
It's just going to be a mess.
It's going to be a dirty ass mess.
Oh my gosh.
But it was good.
Yeah.
It was delicious.
Nice. You never go back. Once you hit the Big Mac level, and you never
go back, never
to the cheeseburger.
Yeah, you never go back
for it again. Yeah.
Mm-mm. You don't need it again.
I was going to say you don't go back to like regular hamburgers.
Yeah.
What's your Big Mac story, Andy?
I was at a friend's house, and like I was staying over for the night or whatever. So like his parents were like, hey, like, you know, we'll get McDonald's. I'll go out and get it. Like, tell me what everybody wants. And I said like something completely different. Like,
you can have
like,
anything you want.
I was like, just get me like a 2 cheeseburgers and that's it or something. And somehow my order became a Big Mac at some point. So they came back and was like, here's your food. And I was like,
and you're like, is this for me?
I was like, but this isn't what I ordered. But I was like too embarrassed to say anything. Cause I was like, I don't want to be difficult. I'll just eat it. It's fine. And then I've been in the thing. I was like, oh my God, this is incredible.
Oh my God.
I was like, I think. I just became an adult.
Well, this Big Mac is really good.
The hype is real.
All right, Brad.
Yeah.
Hit us.
So the Big Mac always was the adult thing. And you, as a kid, you want to do adult stuff.
Of course.
You want to smoke. You get those candy cigarettes.
You
want to
sit at the adult table at Thanksgiving?
Yeah. You're done with that kid stuff.
Yeah.
You want to watch R-rated movies. And you want to eat a Big Mac.
You're like 12. Yes. You're basically a teen, which is basically like 30. Mm-hmm. You know?
Your life is over.
Yeah.
My grandma used to watch us a lot. And I remember going to McDonald's with her at some point. Like going to the, because we went to the play place and we just have a fun time. And I just remember like building up the courage to ask my grandma, can I have a Big Mac? And she was like hesitant about it. And she's like, yeah, you can have a Big Mac. And I was like, oh boy, here we go.
Today I become a man.
Sat down and like looked at this thing. I'm like, this is the greatest food that's ever existed. After this moment, I will be an adult. And I just bit into that Big Mac, and it was so good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My grandma was, like, so happy and, like, proud. Like, it was like seeing your kid, like, walk for the first time, you know? She got to see me eat a Big Mac for the first time.
How would you feel if we all ate a Big Mac between this and our next episode?
I would probably do that anyway.
I had a Big Mac like 3 weeks ago. I'll have another Big Mac, sure.
It's a big deal for you.
I don't order McDonald's burgers. Yeah. I haven't had a Big Mac, I don't know how long. I know I probably, like, the last time I had it was just a goof.
Well, what's unfortunate?
Just a goof.
There's no way
I really want this thing, but I haven't had it in a while.
Yeah, just get me one.
That's I'm going to have to go back and revisit that quad stack challenge.
Oh, no. That was a bad idea for food.
Those were the fast food days.
Oh, the quad stacker?
The quad stacker.
Yeah, that was a nightmare.
It can't be. Like, the big problem with the Big Mac now is they have the new, what's the quarter pounder, is 100% beef now, but like everything else in the menu isn't yet.
Oh, right.
They just passed legislation in Canada, or I don't know if it was like legislation, but they just did it in general. But they started to put 100% beef inside their cheeseburgers, their Big Macs, and quarter pounders in Canada. Hmm. So, like, who knows what's even in this sandwich unit?
I don't know if it was...
And I have had a Quarter Pounder recently, and it is juicy and good. It tastes like a hamburger, finally. Mm. It's something at McDonald's you can get that tastes like a thing you would get in real life.
There's a different documentary that was all about... It was about, like, the meat industry.
There's a couple different ones.
Chicken farms, sure. Like, they got all this undercover footage of, like, the horrific conditions at, like, these poultry farms and stuff.
Is that Food Inc.?
It might be.
Yeah.
Because in that one, they talk about how... McDonald's is sort of not necessarily the reason, but like one of the big pressures that kind of created this horrific like industry of like animal treatment, because
they're feeding so many people with, like, every day.
It's not just that. It's not just that they're feeding so many. It's the fact that as a company, they have a mission to with their brand. They want a burger at any McDonald's in the world to taste the same. And so, like, they have to source a ton of meat, and they're extremely specific about the meat they're sourcing and how much of it from which places so that they can maintain that consistency. And so, like, their order of meat alone can, like, creates this global meat industry of, like, just, you know, warehouses full of animals.
That makes
sense.
It's
pretty nuts. And, like, the idea that, like, yeah, you could be in, like, Tokyo and just get a Big Mac, and it's going to taste the same as a Big Mac you would get here. It probably look better because they tend to make things look nicer in those, from what I understand. But
are you aware that Super Size 2 is coming out? Super Size Me 2 is out or is coming out?
I haven't heard that.
It's about him, Morgan Spurlock, trying to make his own restaurant and just trying to get, like, good food inside of it. And he, like, goes inside the industry of, like, what it actually takes to be, like, a franchised restaurant, just how crazy difficult it is.
That could be pretty interesting.
It seems like a very interesting documentary.
I feel bad for this. I feel like he found the one thing that worked for him, and he's been trying to recapture that ever since. Because he had the TV series.
I thought the TV series was great.
I liked the 30 TV days. Show.
Yeah, basically he did like the same premise of this documentary, but with different things.
What was that movie? Wonderful. It was like, we want to sell you this movie. It was like presented by Palmade. He made a movie that was like, he wanted the movie to be 100% branded through advertisement.
Yeah.
And he, like, pitched it through all the movies and, like, went to advertising meetings, and he just tried to get his entire documentary funded through advertising. He ended up doing it too.
Yeah.
I forget what it was called, but
interesting.
And then he was working on Super Size Me 2, and then he went ahead and Me Too'd himself.
Yes, he did.
Morgan Spurlock. This is what you didn't know.
He Me Too'd himself.
Yeah, he came out and said that he had cheated on his wife.
Yeah, he was trying to get ahead of it, and
he had sexually harassed some workers that he had been with. Patting ladies on the butt and saying suggestive things. He had this big, long Twitter thing that he posted. And he just kind of went away for a couple years. Like 3 or 4 years. And he's finally coming back with this movie that was made 3 or 4 years ago, but he was just, like, holding on to it because he knew no one's going to see it after that letter came out.
Yep, sure.
So, we'll see if it's been enough time.
Well, I mean, I guess I can give him credit for at least admitting it without, like, someone just...
going for it?
Yeah. Leading him into it. Like, he
got ahead of his own story.
Yeah, he brought it up himself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if it's happened, I guess, like, that's... You don't want it to happen in the first place, but at least, I guess...
But we don't need to talk about that.
No,
that's true. Let's not talk about that.
I was bringing it up.
Yeah.
Just to get it out of the way.
That's interesting, though. I'm interested in the premise of the new one.
Yeah, it seemed really interesting. Mm-hmm. He, like, goes through, like, chicken farms and beef farms and tries to, like, see what it's all about and try to make, like, a good burger and consistent... He goes to, like, a couple of different places, like, trying to buy a franchise and, like, starting his own thing.
Yeah, like, hearing, I mean, the restaurant business in general just seems like such a nightmare to try and get into and, like, to operate in. And
yeah, if you just buy a franchise, like, everything's done for you. Everything just comes in packages. That's why there's, like, so many dang Subways everywhere, because it's, like, one of the easiest businesses to run. You just have to heat that, like, weird bread up, and then the ingredients just, like, come in bags.
Yeah.
And the menu's there, and you just toast it, and
so
you go.
Gross. That's so gross to think about. It's like an endless supply of the same old garbage.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Day in and day out, that same garbage coming in.
Ugh.
And coming out.
All right, now I'm going to go get a Subway sandwich. Bye, guys.
So he ends up getting his vitals back, and they're not good.
No.
He's doing real bad.
He's in bad shape.
High cholesterol. He's, you know, put on some weight.
Yeah.
You could tell.
And it's just bad business. The doctors are, like, telling him to stop, and he's like, I'm not going to stop.
His quality of life was just bad. Like, he was saying, like, he just feels incredibly lethargic all the time.
Loses his sex drive.
Yeah, he just, like, feels like crap.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, it's hard to say how much is, like, mental and how much is actually a physical reaction to just eating that much of that food. But, yeah, I mean, you really do see a dramatic transition for him over the course of the film.
Mm-hmm. And I forget if he, like, says he's, like, never going to eat McDonald's again or how it really, like, peters out. But
Yeah.
I don't think he says that.
Yeah. I don't know what happens at the end.
I think he's just kind of
better and moves on. And
he
kind of
just tells the results and he lets what happened
speak for itself.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. One thing that he did end up, this is interesting, he ended up getting the supersize to go away.
Oh, yeah.
That was the response. Right. But that shit's back.
Is it back?
Yeah, they have that.
I didn't know they had. Really? They had like a different.
They brought it right back.
Hmm.
They were like, we'll just hide it for a little while.
Do they still call it like specifically the supersize?
I don't think they do. I don't think but it those is. Large sizes are I think they just shifted their size now as they were then.
I always hate when that happens. I'll be like, what size? At a big thing, I'll be like, just a medium or something. Like,
yeah, it's like
there is no medium.
Yeah, because like, and then they give you an enormous cup and like
Taco Bell
like,
does
this
that.
Is the medium, and I was like. What is this?
Taco Bell does that. If you get a large drink, they
I think
give
there's
you
a small
an
and large
cup.
There. Yeah. I don't think they have a medium at Taco
it's
Bell.
It's crazy.
I think they just labeled them.
Yeah, they just took it and moved it over.
Yeah. Like a medium is actually a large at every other place.
In New York, I think they restrict how much is in a drink.
They did restrict soda sizes.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's still in effect.
I think
they tried to have
the
like soda tax. I think that. Did not go well.
Yeah.
I always just say the smallest size. Please, God, give me the smallest size.
Yeah. I feel like they should also have, this is obviously they're not going to do this, they should have a combo price that excludes the drink.
Then it's not a combo.
They make the money off the drinks, man.
Of course they make the money off the drinks.
They make so much money off the drinks.
Because it's like takes no syrup whatsoever. It's like pennies to the dollar.
There's a corn dog place that I go to in the summertime in Grand Haven, and they charge a dollar for their soft drinks. That thing costs, got to be like 3 cents.
Yeah.
Of course.
That place is making money just solely off the drinks that they're selling. The profit margin is insane.
But if I go there, I'm going to want the burger and the fries.
You don't want the drink?
I don't want the drink ever.
I get unsweetened
like
tea
ever.
If I can as a drink.
Yeah.
But that's it. That's like the only thing I'll have at the fast food restaurant. Soda is just too gross. I'm not a soda guy. But I like
carbonation. Soda machines, but still, even them, I'm looking at like,
yeah, you get to choose. I get like a sparkling water in there. But, you know, you never know what's going on in that stuff. Natural and artificial flavors.
Yeah.
McDonald's Coke, though, is like a different breed.
I was about to bring that up, actually.
Dear Lord. That's like
that is specifically it's crack. Like McDonald's Coke.
That one has more cocaine in it or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you guys ever watch the Ray Kroc document or movie with Michael Keaton?
Mm-hmm. Batman?
I think it's called Founder.
It is. The Founder.
I have not seen that.
It's pretty good.
Mm. They don't talk about Coke as much, but.
No, they don't. But you get to see how he got involved in McDonald's and how he turned it into what it's become.
Yeah, it was basically a real estate company because he just kept buying land after like land.
That's what the story. That's been the story.
They're
for
not
a number
of restaurant.
Places. I'm trying.
A realty company.
I'm trying to think. Like NPR or something. They did a piece on like the automats, the old like where you used to be able to go and like get food in a like that was just pre-prepared in a box and just pay for it and take it out.
Hmm.
And like. Almost overnight, these things like popped up everywhere in New York and then across like multiple cities.
What year are we talking about?
Like 30s to the 50s, I think, was sort of the heyday of the automats.
I had never heard about this.
And they were like, you would get like, rich people, poor people, everyone would just go to the automat because it was an easy way to sit down, have a quick lunch and then get out of there and go do something else. And they talk about like how there was like a sort of a decline in its ability to operate at that as much of a profit margin as it used to. And then like the company that ended up owning it eventually, like which had bought up the automat brand, basically was like realized that the real estate, all of their automats were in was actually more valuable than the automats themselves. Mm-hmm. So they just scrapped it and just like ended up selling the real estate instead. It's sort of a weird thing.
It basically happened with McDonald's.
Yeah.
Ray Kroc was like, well, I own the land where your McDonald's are sitting, and I own all of them.
If you got
own some of the business.
Every McDonald's back to back, like could it feel like a state? What kind of square footage would every McDonald's be if you just lined them all up?
I bet that'd be like its own small little European country.
You think so?
Yeah,
it'd be like almost like a Denmark or something.
Like Moldova,
maybe something bigger.
Bro, like every square mile.
Yeah, I think McDonald's could be a country.
A little Montenegro over there,
without a doubt.
McDonald's Agro.
All right, we're going to watch Super Size Me, and we'll see what we got right and what we got wrong, and interesting things that we find out. Maybe Andy eats a
Big Mac. Maybe we'll
eat a Big Mac.
Yeah.
Oh, what a big deal for you. It's going to be a big day for that big
boy. I'm going to eat it on the podcast.
Are you?
No.
Oh, no. It'll be old, maybe.
They're like, Andy loves Big Macs.
Oh, no.
Follow Andy Loves Chips, andyloveschips.com. Bye.
In 2002, a few Americans got fed up with being overweight and did what we do best. They sued the bastards. Taking aim at the fast food companies and blaming them for their obesity and illnesses, a lawsuit was filed in New York on behalf of two teenage girls. One who is 14 years old, 4'10", and 170 pounds. The other, 19 years old, 5'6", and 270 pounds. The unthinkable had suddenly become reality. People were suing the Golden Arches for selling them food that most of us know isn't good for you to begin with. Yet each day, one in four Americans visits a fast food restaurant. And this hunger for fast food isn't just in America. It's happening on a global basis. McDonald's alone operates more than 30,000 joints in over 100 countries on six continents and feeds more than 46 million people worldwide every day. That's more than the entire population of Spain. In the United States alone, McDonald's accounts for 43% of the total fast food market. They're everywhere. Walmarts, airports, rest stops, gas stations, train stations, shopping malls, department stores, amusement parks, even hospitals. That's right, hospitals. At least you're close when the coronary kicks in. Lawyers for McDonald's call the suits frivolous, stating that the dangers of its food are universally known and that these kids can't show that their weight problems and health woes were caused solely by their McDiets. The judge states, however, that if lawyers for the teens can show that McDonald's intends for people to eat its food for every meal of every day and that doing so would be unreasonably dangerous, they may be able to state a claim. Are the food companies solely to blame for this epidemic? Where does personal responsibility stop and corporate responsibility begin? Is fast food really that bad for you?
I mean, what would happen if I ate nothing but McDonald's for 30 days straight? Would I suddenly be on the fast track to becoming an obese American? Would it be unreasonably dangerous? Let's find out. I'm ready.
Welcome back to the Mac Attack Podcast. Andy Moldenhauer is eating a Big Mac.
Right now, literally.
This isn't I just finished it.
Yeah.
No napkin. There is napkins. It's right there.
All right, took my last bite.
You're a mess. Take that, please.
How did you like your Big Mac? Did we each have a Big Mac this week?
I did. Yep.
Brad didn't.
I did.
You did?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
I want to be part of the team.
That doesn't sound very real.
What do you mean? What else did I have to say?
Just say, sure. You're supposed to say, of course I did.
Well, why? Well, you know, I
of course
for,
I did.
Did it for
What's
the
difference?
He did it.
We all did it.
We all did it.
Did you? How did you like it?
It's not good.
It needs tomato.
No,
I'm
get
a tomato
out of
boy.
Here. Get I'm out of here.
I'm a tomato
get
boy.
Get the hell out.
If they're putting tomato on it, then they're taking that Thousand Island dressing off because that sounds gross together.
Yeah, that's
you
would no
need
way.
A salad has tomatoes on it and Thousand Island dressing.
Not my salads. Get those tomatoes.
That's
out
my
here.
Favorite combo. Tomato is combination.
Tomatoes are a garbage food, and you're both garbage people because you like them.
No, tomatoes are great.
No,
I love a tomato.
Pass.
You're that pizza sauce guy and ketchup man.
Yeah.
I would take the cheese off that, because that cheese was gross.
The cheese is gross.
All tomatoes do is just add off-flavored water to whatever you're eating. That's what they do.
It gives that crunch factor.
No, they're juicy. They're soggy. What crunch is there? Oh, my gosh.
I get double
it's like
tomatoes,
it's like
double
a...
cukes.
Oh, boy.
Oh, I just had the Big Mac burp.
You're having that reaction that... Sprolak had the first mm-hmm. supersize he ate.
Yes.
See, now's the time of the meal when you start getting the McStomach ache. Right now, I got some McGas that's rocking. My arm.
Are you sweating there?
My arms. I feel like I got some McSweats going. My arms got the McTwitches going in here from all the sugar that's going in my body right now. I'm dying.
Oh, man.
Oh, that was so gross.
I ate mine in the car.
No, the Big Mac.
Well, it's designed to be eaten in a car.
It's not,
right?
Though. I can't be.
Can it be?
It can't be. It's way too messy
it's
to be.
It's fast food.
We talked about that in part one. It's like the shredded lettuce
the
gets
shredded
everywhere.
Shredded lettuce gets everywhere.
And then the sauce starts coming out the back
the
as you
eat it. The
sauce
and the pickles just.
It's,
and the onions.
It's useless.
Keep flopping out.
Yeah, it falls
out, of that
out the
thing.
Back.
So
yeah.
You can kind of make a tray with the Big Mac box that they have it in.
Yeah.
But you can sort of just like feed yourself like you're a robot, just putting sustenance in your conveyor belt.
I would never attempt this in a car. I was like, I like my car too much. I wouldn't make
hamburgers
that mess.
Hamburgers are made
there.
To be the car food.
No, Crunch Wraps are made to be the car food, Brad. Taco Bell won that battle.
Brad, you know, you're just like fast food.
Mm-hmm.
Because I want to take you out and eat you in my car.
Oh.
Cut that out.
Wait, is that the part of the Leslie Willis song?
No, but Wesley Willis is in this, and I forgot about that.
Yeah, surprise appearance by Andy Moldenhauer, favorite.
Rock and roll McDonald's.
Which makes sense.
McDonald's is a place to rock. It is a restaurant where they buy food to eat. It is a good place to listen to the music. People flock here to get down to the rock music. Rock and roll McDonald's. Rock and roll.
Because this was about McDonald's, guys. Did you know that?
Did you just realize that, Andy?
Yeah, I mean, I'm realizing a lot of things now. I was realizing I was pretty bored watching this one. I don't know if I'm just spoiled with the glut of documentaries available today. But
you didn't
appreciate
the fact that this is an indie film?
I don't know.
Is an indie
documentary. It really is, because I was reading, like, the budget was, like, 60 grand, and, like...
Yeah, he was just going around with a camera and a microphone.
They made some real money off this one because they like.
Oh, this movie was huge,
dude! It was like 60 mil they brought back. It's crazy. Ten x that investment there.
Yeah, he was first to strike gold on the food documentaries.
Yeah, I actually enjoyed it. I watched it twice.
Oh, gosh,
I watched it
pass.
One and a half times.
I barely got through.
Oh, the first time. I watched it like one and like 3/4 of the way,
mm-hmm.
just to kind of like see it one more time and see if I missed anything.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was bored.
I remember seeing this film and it being inspiring me to be a filmmaker because it's like he's using a crappy mini DV camera and like just like microphones and he's just kind of like sneaking into places.
I did appreciate that. This was like kind of one of the first big theater feature run and guns, like where he's just like showing up in a place and being like, hey, can we film here? Thanks, bye.
Mm-hmm.
Right, because he's walking through McDonald's in some shots. And he's just holding the camera in his. Mm-hmm. He's like got it around his like armpit, basically.
Yeah.
And this is similar. I mean, like documentary style, guerrilla style, mm-hmm. similar to that documentary where the guy tries to get a date with Drew Barrymore.
Oh, yeah.
It's like the same.
I forgot about that documentary.
You remember
that
one?
That is a good one.
Came out like 2 years after this.
That was,
But the food is gross.
Mm.
The food looks so gross.
Some of the food looks
I forgot
gross.
That the salad came in a cup container.
Yes.
That was the first McDonald's salad.
Yep.
The shaker. You get to to shake it up.
Well, that's still a style. You still do that.
I don't think that comes
No,
with
not
McDonald's
from
anymore.
McDonald's ones. They come in like...
Maybe not McDonald's.
You can still
but
shake them because they come... But they come in like the wide trays now,
yeah.
sort of. And you can like have a lid so you can still shake mm-hmm. it, which is good mm-hmm. because if... That is my preferred way of getting dressing on a salad.
Yes.
I hate trying
the best way.
I hate stirring a salad. It just means it's going to get all off my plate.
I'm a fork dipper. I dip the fork in the dressing.
Oh man,
I've adapted to that.
I've never really tried that, but
it's
I don't
like
know if that
a
would work for
it's
me.
It's a life changing thing. I don't know. Food Network.
Food Network.
I don't know.
You go to Fork College. You went to Fork.
I went
college
to Fork College. Fork Cornell. I thought that was going to work, and it didn't.
You know what, though? It didn't.
No.
I thought it was going to.
Andy called that Filet-O-Fish scene.
That's in the
hotel, and he's just like, look at this. And he just lifts it up, and everyone's just
that
like,
poor
oh,
sandwich.
No.
You could tell, too, because the bread stuck to the cheese, so it had been like just sitting there for a while.
Yeah.
Like, when he tried to pull it apart, like some of the bread was just
the ketchup
stuck.
Had fused the cheese to the bread.
Like, was there ketchup on the Filet-O-Fish?
I don't know if there is.
It was like tartar sauce.
Oh, okay, yeah.
It's just the Filet-O-Fish, American
cheese,
and tartar sauce. Ugh.
Oh, boy. Yeah,
it's a frightening sandwich.
I also thought it was funny how, like, you know, they talk the rules are up front where he's like, you know, which we mentioned, I think, most of them, where he has to go through every item on the menu and all the other stuff. And, like, they mentioned the go through every item, like oh, man, what a task that's going to be. And he's like, I did that in 9 days, and now I'm really bored with all this food.
It's
oh,
all kind
I don't
of the
wanna,
same
I'm,
thing.
I don't want to keep eating it.
The menu was pretty limited in 2004.
There was
a lot of burger stuff, not a lot of chicken things.
And I think
there's
the reason...
There's still, like, no sides.
Right, I was going to say, I think the reason that the menu is so much bigger now is in part because of this movie. Is, like, this movie really got... a lot of those restaurants to expand their offerings and at least attempt the appearance of offering a lot more healthy
I would say
foods.
Out of the fast food places, Wendy's does a good job of having good sides and good
they
options.
They got that baked potato.
Baked potato.
That's like
they
a,
got
that's
the
a
chili.
Huge winner.
Yeah, they have a bunch of healthier sides, but I'm putting healthy in quotes.
Yeah.
That potato with nothing on it, if you don't like dump a bunch of cheese or whatever on it, it's a good potato.
My understanding is
that'd be good for you.
Taco Bell is one of the easiest places to eat good low-cal stuff. Like, they've got like the Baja Fresh menu and a lot of like, you can just, you know, if you substitute out some of the
Fresca.
Yeah, maybe.
Where it's like no cheese.
Yeah, there's and you can like substitute out a lot of the stuff that would have calories with plenty of, they have like so many other ingredients you can put in that don't. And
they have pretty low quality meat, but if you don't get that, if you sub that with a bunch anymore, of stuff.
That's not true anymore,
Brad. It feels like it is.
No, that was.
It sold the taste kind of bad.
No, that was an urban legend.
Urban legend.
Wait, what was the urban legend?
The D quality beef.
They were like, oh, they have like cardboard filler in their beef even.
Oh, the Taco Bell
terrible
thing.
Quality. And like, yeah. Like Taco Bell like a, straight up was like, it was like, hey, we will straight up release our meat inspection report. It turned out they had like some of the best meat in the entire fast food biz. We're like,
yeah, which is probably still like C level meat.
It's supposed to not be bad, but who knows, really? Yeah, I mean, at this point, I don't trust any of that stuff.
Did you work for Taco Bell?
Are you
working for Big TB?
Big TB?
Big TB? Big tuberculosis.
I wasn't offended. I was just like, it sounds different than what you meant.
They call me Big TB.
It sounds like you have a lot of tuberculosis.
Yeah.
Well, it's big. You're big time. You're Biggie TB. They don't have Biggie size anymore.
No.
That's gone.
Super size.
Six months after this movie, disappear.
Yep.
Their stuff's very large.
What's the largest size?
I think it's just called large.
It's just large. And it is not, they didn't just shift everything up like and change the names. They really did get rid of the super size.
Yeah, that is gone.
Good, good.
Man, when he had the first time he brought out the supersized cup.
Those were so big.
Holy crap. That was like a liter massive. Of cola. And I had plenty of jokes about Super Troopers there. But like, it was genuinely like a liter-sized cup of soda.
That lady said that was like 600 to 800 calories.
Yeah.
And empty calories,
man,
too.
When they covered like the 7-Eleven Big Gulps, too. Like, I mentioned that. And like,
forgot about the gaseous bypass surgery in this movie. Major
Big Gulp that he's like, it's like a straight up half gallon.
Cars have introduced larger cup holders to accommodate those huge 7-Eleven double gulps, which are 64 ounces, a half gallon, and hold anywhere from 600 to 800 calories, depending on how much ice you put in.
A half gallon of soda.
A half gallon of soda for one person, 48 teaspoons of sugar.
I gotta be honest.
Ooh, that Big Mac's coming up.
Bubble in my throat.
You got a Big Mac stuck in there.
I gotta be honest.
Big Mac attack.
Some of my family would drink those largest Big Gulp cups. One a day.
Kids in high school would do
one
it.
One a day for years. Because
if you
get
the big one, you get like super cheap refills. So a lot of them would get the really big one and keep filling it up because you could do it for like a dollar. And yeah, like they drink so much soda.
It's so bad for you.
I skipped the surgery scene because I remember the being in the movie and I was like, I don't want to watch it.
You skipped
I'm gonna skip it. I'm gonna skip the 2 minutes of seeing the surgery.
I don't think they showed it. Or no, they did actually. Yeah they did.
I know
they showed for shock value.
I know this guy didn't because he loves to watch videos of
surgery. That was tame compared to what I've seen. I've seen like amputation videos.
Oh jeez.
These are like surgery. It's not like someone in the field doing it. It's like a medical procedure.
Okay, you watch it like amputations in a meadow? Like that's the kind
of
brutal...
let me ask you, like, if you go to med school, do you have to watch this stuff?
I don't know.
If you're going
to
get into that field.
This was half the
reason. You work on cadavers. My friend's wife.
Why can't I watch it just for interest?
My friend's wife's, like a group of students, get a cadaver for the year. And you just work on that cadaver and you do stuff to the cadaver.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a guy. Or gal.
That'd be interesting.
Just for like a few group of students to work on.
Yeah, I used to work for Wayne State Med. And it was weird when you'd like, there was cadaver day when like all the students get groups and they get assigned their cadaver. And like, you had to make sure that, like, you know, I was just doing like tech support. So, but we had to make sure like the x-ray boxes worked, like all the lights were fine. And we like test all the gear in there. I was like, this is creepy because they're just all laying out there with sheets over them.
You used to think they're going to pop up like zombies and get you.
It was the creepiest day of work.
Oh, boy. So that's why I watch medical videos.
Yeah, no, I mean, I'm not
intrigued.
So that when you go to med school, you'll be ready.
It started with wisdom teeth extraction.
I remember you getting
the because I wanted them so bad because I couldn't even like...
You wanted wisdom teeth?
I wanted them out. Like, I couldn't even really close my mouth completely when I had them.
Brutal.
So it was uncomfortable. So I was like, what is that like?
Yeah.
And then you just go down the rabbit hole.
I got mine out when I was 18. Never looked back. Get those teeth out of there.
I got mine out when I was 26. That was long enough.
I'm trying to think. I got mine out. I was probably about 27 when I got mine out.
A little older.
Yeah.
Gotta get those suckers out of there.
But that guy was getting gastric bypass surgery.
Mm-hmm. Because he's so big.
Yeah.
So much soda.
Yeah. Yeah.
So much soda.
The same problem with him. Yeah, he was drinking too much pop. And even his wife was saying how much pop she was drinking. It sounded like way too much as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's a soda family. And I didn't realize until they pointed out in the documentary that only like four things on the menu don't have sugar in it.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, oh, that's interesting. There's so much freaking sugar in this McDonald's stuff. It is a drug that they're serving you. McDonald's itself. Sure. It's addictive.
Yeah. I mean,
legal
it's like
cocaine.
A whole culture too.
Yeah. It's weird. Mm-hmm. There's a good Adam Ruins Everything where he talks about sugar and how in air quotes, big sugar like really pushed. It's weird how many parallels there are between like the sugar industry's lobbying and like the tobacco industry's lobbying.
Sure.
And how like it sugar obviously just never had the image problem that smoking did, so it was never followed up on. And like it's so bonkers to like think about how much sugar is in stuff all the time. And one of the main reasons is because it is addictive. And
well, I think even there's a sugar documentary that came out like in the last 5 years, and it talked about how the sugar industry was able to deflect the people gaining weight to fatty foods.
Yep.
and just no, it's not us. It's this over
it's
here
fats.
That's actually happening.
And like, no, it's definitely the sugars, but it was a successful lobbying.
And they were able to make that work for decades.
Yeah,
I feel like if you're part of any group of like food and you're at a McDonald's, whether it be sugar or beef or chicken or wheat or anything, you're making pretty good bank because there's just so many McDonald's.
Yeah.
You have to provide so much food for this company.
Mm-hmm.
Potato farmers, like they only have French fries. You can get like a little Apple kid snack, but like that's it. And just it's such a...
Yeah, I mean, they're like a world market. They're all over the world.
So there has to be potatoes everywhere and cows everywhere.
Exactly, yeah.
To feed McDonald's.
I do kind of like, I don't know if this is 100% or just me reading the menu wrong, but like the last time I was in there, I was looking at the kids' meal that you can get now, and it's like soda's not even an option that is listed. Like you can get like milk or juice or like two or three other things, and there is like no option to have a soda as a part of the kids' meal.
Yeah.
I was like, that's pretty cool. Like, I
think that's fair,
that.
But like, I'd still be concerned about the juice.
Oh, yeah.
Certainly.
Because the juice is going to have a ton
I'm sure
of sugar.
It's
as
have
much
it.
Sugar, probably.
Just water, unsweetened tea are like the only things you could get at McDonald's drink-wise that aren't going to be terrible for you. I also forgot in the documentary that he actually goes into a school. And I know this has like been done a lot since then, but he like goes through all like the school processes of the food they're getting and what's in it. And it's sort of like outside the documentary. It feels like its own little... It could be its own documentary and it's in and of itself, and it is in other places.
Right.
But I had forgot that it even showed up in this one.
Yeah, I think it's very fitting, though, for the documentary, because it's exploring the fact that kids learn at an early age, like, what type of foods to eat. And and they learn that in school. And so if school is offering bad choices, they're only going to want to choose from these bad choices, or they'll feel more comfortable in that, like, area.
And even apart from choosing bad food, learning to choose these bad foods is, like, a lot of these kids don't have that choice. Like, they go there and they get what the school gives them. And if the school's giving them crappy food, like, you know, the parents can only do so much if they're feeding them, like, a healthy dinner. If they're eating a crappy lunch every day. I mean,
right.
And you have to get accustomed to eating healthy. It's so easy to just get used to eating bad food, right?
There's definitely, there is.
I would never want vegetables as a kid, but if I had cooked them in a certain way or like done something, maybe I would have been convinced. But
yeah, and there
even
is
mentality of a kid is just like McDonald's playland. You know, I want the toys. I want the fun things. Every time I eat something, it needs to be fun.
Right.
It should never just be for sustenance or like the healthiest thing I can have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As a kid, I just like, you don't put that together and make good choices.
Right. And there's truth too to when you consume like that, those amounts of like sugar and stuff, your palate is sort of annulled to it. So like, I mean, there's plenty of stories of like when you cut out a lot of sugar, things that are like seemed like flavorless to you suddenly become a lot more tasty because your mouth is sort of readjusting your palate to a much lower sugar content. And they're like, that's sort of where your mouth should have been, but it's become accustomed to the amount of sugar that is put into a lot of these processed foods.
Yeah, I'll cut sugar out every once in a while, and just like a piece of corn or like a sweet pea will taste like so sweet to me. Like vegetables will start to taste sweet again. Ones that are sweet. Carrot? Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
So sweet.
The other thing too that was happening is he was becoming addicted to the sugar rush because he was drinking so much soda that his brain adapted to the sugar and was like, you need more and more sugar to keep fueling because you crash so fast.
Right.
So he was like feeling really bad because his body like quickly adjusted to it and just kept craving it. He literally got addicted to it.
Another rule we forgot to mention in part one was that he could only walk 5,000 steps a day because that was like the average amount like a person in America walks. Mm-hmm. He's usually walking miles in New York, so it was like a big change to cut out that exercise.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he excluded all exercise completely, just aside from walking max 5,000 steps. Mm-hmm.
Very sentient lifestyle.
Yeah, because he was trying to make it as realistic as possible for the average American that consumes McDonald's.
Right.
So it is built on the premise that McDonald's said that they understood their food was not the healthiest, but they said that it wasn't them that directly cause people to get fat, which I think they do have an argument there. But they're also saying like the only way that they would consider if their food was bad for you is if someone ate it for every meal.
Yeah, which is this was the inspiration for the documentary was the lawsuit from like two families filing saying like that their kids were obese due to McDonald's.
And McDonald's says if you can't prove it, then
that's a really tough case to prove because you're right. You do have to be able to prove that it was directly McDonald's and that to the exclusion of like any other causes. And that's like, that's why you find it. Like, even cases where like a company like just dumped toxic waste in like a town's river, it is still incredibly difficult to prove that caused like everyone in the town to get cancer because that's such a huge bar to like jump over.
Mm-hmm.
Those would be really tough cases. And there are like reading through the Wikipedia for the movie too, they talk about there was a number of like follow up sort of not like responses directly, but like people who did essentially the same challenge as him and were like, I lost a bunch of weight. It's just sort of how you manage it. And talking about like not obviously the supersizing, I think, was a big part of his issues with the health. Like when they talk about like as long as you're getting regular portions, it's actually not horrific to eat this stuff every day.
Right.
The problem is when you're eating the amount of calories that come in the humongous sizes that they offer.
Yeah, the Big Mac you just ate only has like 600 calories in it.
Yeah,
it's like a reasonable meal.
It's really not that many calories in a single Big Mac. It's surprisingly less than you would think, at least. The biggest thing is like, but if you get, you know, the supersized fries, that's more calories
than
the
Big Mac itself was. That's where you're going to do the damage with the fries and the soda.
You can double or triple your calorie intake just with the soda and the fries on the side, and depending on how big they are.
Right. Although the other thing you got to consider, too, is the food groups that you're getting from the food you're consuming.
Yes. Yeah, that's true.
So if it's more carbohydrates, more sugars, fats, protein, I mean, the mix-up does matter as well.
He met up with a nutritionist, a gastroenterologist, and a general practitioner in the film.
And a cardiologist. Yeah, to check his heart.
The nutritionist was always like trying to get him to like take a multivitamin or just like drink more water. And like, he's like, they had the most like fighting, I would say, out of the two things, like playing it. And they're playing it
like
up a
playful
bit.
Fighting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The other clips of just the doctors were just like kind of just check-ins and their opinions on stuff. But
what do you think of the doctors? Did you have any feelings about them?
They're playing it up a little bit.
It seemed,
especially the general practitioner guy.
Yeah,
like he was like almost casted.
I was like, I don't know how I'd feel about him as a doctor. He was so indifferent about everything. Like he didn't want to say his opinion one way or the other. It was almost like a weird, like he knew it could be like legally, like gray because it's also being filmed as well.
Yeah,
right.
So he wasn't really agreeing to anything or disagreeing with anything.
He was like one of the least like.
And then the cardiologist guy seemed like
he was animated.
He was like, it's not going to really do anything. It's going to raise your triglycerides, and that's it.
Yeah.
I think he downplayed very skeptical. it quite a bit.
Yeah.
Guys, can we talk about another famous person that does make an appearance in this film that was kind of weird and very strange in today's modern age? Jared Fogle.
Oh, yes.
Oh.
Yes, I'm glad you brought that
talking
up.
Talking to a bunch of like kids in school.
How inspiring was he in this film? at the time.
Oh, boy.
He's talking about doing good stuff for
that
kids.
Segment, when that turn came in, it blew my mind because I was like, oh, that's right.
Uh-huh.
And he talks about how he got like teased as a kid and how he like felt bad. And I'm just like thinking in my head of like who he is now and like how he felt then. Yep. And I'm like, oh, my God.
And I feel so like the mom and the daughter, they're like telling him like how much it means to yeah. like give her like the daughter hope that like, you know, she can, you know, eat healthy and this stuff. And he's like, I really like helping kids. And I'm sitting there like, ooh.
The daughter took like a bad message away too. Cause she was like, I can't afford 2 sandwiches a day. Yes. I was like, that's not the exact message.
Yes.
What he was
yeah.
trying to get
yes.
across.
I right. had the exact same thought. I was right. like, I don't really think that's what he was saying.
Right.
I can't eat 2 sandwiches.
But
a day.
I almost got the feeling that the mom was like kind of pushing her to share her story, because it was yeah. actually just the mom sharing the story.
It really was.
And I was mean, like, this is a little odd.
Yeah, well, if you're that girl, like, I'm sure she's just like, I don't need to be in a documentary talking about my weight. Thanks, Mom. I'm in a high, like, I'm
to
in
a
school,
clear pedophile.
All my kids are going to, yeah. Well, now. All my classmates are going to be making fun of me, Mom. Mom's like, all right, this is our 15 minutes, girl. You better get in line.
Yeah, it very much felt that way.
But it was definitely weird hitting that moment in the documentary, being like, oh boy.
The feel-good moment of this movie.
And yeah.
The Jared
no,
Fuzzle
it is.
Speech.
Thinking about how that was,
it was like a balloon
received
just
at
deflating.
The time, you're like, oh man. Like, because that was like a big mania when his, like, uh-huh. that whole
So he's
campaign.
In prison now?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, probably for the rest of his life, I imagine, or a
for
long
a while,
time.
I think, yeah.
I don't think they have Subways at prisons.
You don't think
he
so?
Might not be able to eat there.
I don't know.
Do you
they got to
get fat again.
They always turn up in weird places.
I don't think you could get fat in prison. That'd be like. I mean,
you don't think so?
I don't think so.
I bet they. Well, they were the same companies that serve the schools serve
true.
At the prison.
Well, I bet they portion
well, yeah.
control.
Let's
though.
Find out when we get those the special.
Haven't you been hearing about
special order?
Have you heard about podcast? Some of what the prisons in Michigan have been dealing with?
Mm-mm.
Oh, they've been dealing with like. Bugs in their food
Ew.
And mold and like things clearly expired and
Aww.
They're serving this to people. Yeah, it was like a huge lawsuit. Like
it's so crazy hearing. Like, I mean, these are all definitely issues, especially like for-profit prisons where, you know, they're trying to just squeeze every penny out. But there's also been a bunch of stories recently, like Alabama has this weird like bylaw where any unused portion of the county's jail food budget, like the sheriff just gets to keep. And
oh,
so there's all these sheriffs
that's
that just like
money,
that they buy like they just buy like bologna and bread and like that's all they'll feed the prisoners because
oh my
anything
God.
All the surplus goes into just they can just do whatever with. And so like he's like, yeah, I bought a second house.
Like
I have a
like
beach
a
house now because of this.
From a,
it's
from a 60s movie.
And how do private prisons work? Do they have like contracts
mm-hmm.
or something like
that? Yep, okay. The state pays them per inmate. And
so it is through like taxpayer money.
So the whole incentive is we need to be able to, you know, house and feed and do all the stuff for this inmate for less than the state is paying us per inmate. And
yeah.
However much less is means that much more profit. So it's like
that's very shady.
Yeah.
That should be illegal.
It's pretty nuts.
But back to McDonald's.
Mackie Donald's.
A different kind of prison.
Ooh.
A prison inside yourself. What'd you guys think of John Lennon eating all those Big Macs?
That guy was definitely
party with Big Mac.
That guy was funny.
I feel like I identified with that guy from when I first ate a Big Mac and I was like, these are delicious. I can eat these all the time. But that dude was a little overboard even mm-hmm. for me.
Yeah, I didn't think everything was like negative necessarily
like,
in the movie.
He was like the first time he had a Big Mac, he like ate
yeah.
6 in one day.
He was loving McDonald's.
He's like, yeah, I got like 3, and then I came back 2 hours later and got 3 more, and then came back 2 hours later and got 3 more. And I was like, to be fair, that sounds like it would have been me in college. That's like something
sure.
I would have done that.
Just,
I'd
yeah.
been
just
like,
for, you know,
more Big Macs,
could do
why
it.
Not? Yeah, exactly.
So,
that too.
And in the movie, he was being shown because he was eating his 19,000.
Yeah, like he's like a
yeah,
McDonald's
he's
celebrity.
He's at like 50,000 mm-hmm. now. I think he just like surpassed.
I had to look it up. Last year in March, he hit 30,000. And he was eating 30,000 Big Macs.
And they're saying like he, I don't know if it was he just proposed or if he actually got married like outside the McDonald's.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah.
First
Big Mac and stuff, like that's interesting. I don't
I know,
say it's bad.
That could have been
like,
you, Andy,
it's
if you would have kept eating those Big Macs.
It's significant
he liked
to him.
It?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
It's significant to him, and I get that. It just seems so strange from an outside perspective, is all.
Sure.
Yeah.
Everyone, the people on the street, like loved McDonald's, and we're talking about how great it was. And I think even like the last scene of the movie where he's throwing the party for himself at McDonald's is a little uplifting, and I kind of want to go to McDonald's.
Yeah.
Did you see that?
It seems like fun.
The nutritionist showed up to the party
oh,
too.
Really
she was like in a couple
notice.
Shots in the background. I was like, oh,
funny.
She's there.
She's like still
the celebratory movie for the film.
No. And two, was it her practice that shut down in the middle
yeah.
of the movie?
Yep.
Okay. That's what I figured.
They had to move buildings or whatever.
Yeah. So what did he learn? What did we learn from this?
You get fat and you eat a lot of sugar.
Yeah, don't eat that many
McDonald's
calories and that much amount of sugar.
And get that amount of exercise.
Yeah.
Seems like a bad move.
Get up and walk around a little bit if you're going to eat that much McDonald's.
There had to have definitely been a lot of copycats, like you were saying.
Yes.
Like after this film, yep. Right?
It sounded like there were a number of people who sort of tried to replicate the results from this. Because, like, I don't know if it was just because they were curious or they were like, clearly that's not accurate. And so they went out to try and do it themselves or whatever. And, yeah, wildly different results depending on who was doing it. And kind of, I think they're kind of, maybe it might have come down to their rules or potentially even just outside factors even that aren't shown, but
right. Plus, you're just studying one person, so someone's experience.
It's not. It could be vastly different. Sample size is way too small to extrapolate.
Right. Exactly. But I think out of anything, like the lawsuit didn't really prove their case, but this movie did. I think prove their case.
I think this movie,
at least in like the public eye.
Yeah, the movie made a big impact. Reading the Wikipedia, they were talking about how in like a lot of theaters, McDonald's was like running ads before the movie to be like, here's what we think about this documentary, basically. And
I love that.
And yeah, talked about how like they just quietly axed the supersize a couple weeks, like 6 weeks or something after the film came out. Yep. And they were like, no, it's not because of the documentary, but like never say
everybody
anything else
knew
about it.
Yeah.
Like, it's because of the documentary.
They said it was because it wasn't selling well, but according to the documentary, like everyone's getting supersized.
Yeah.
It's like, that's a whole big thing.
And it seems like they did kind of change some things about their menu. They introduced the salads like we were talking about. So they tried to be a little bit more health conscious. And they're even still like trying to push towards that.
Yeah. It's going to be right now. It's a giant deal whether or not they go within the Impossible Burger or the Beyond Meat.
Yeah.
In their stores. It's going to happen one or the other. And whatever one they pick is just going to like make all of the money.
Yep. Yes. And it's probably Beyond Meat.
It might be. It's like it's still up to debate which one they want to use.
Burger King's got Impossible locked down right now, you know?
I mean, they might use the same meat as them. I don't know.
But who's going to Burger King?
People like that. Right now, everybody's going to Burger King because of that burger.
Oh,
it's
okay.
It's giant right now.
That's fair. I didn't even consider that.
Mm-hmm. The Chicken Wars happened, and like Burger King was subtly getting this Impossible Burger out, and people were just like taken off guard.
Well, the chicken thing, because of the Popeye's chicken, that thing exploded too.
It's I haven't had one yet.
I want one so bad.
But I want one very bad. Have you
Did
had
you
one
hear
yet?
Someone no, pulled out a gun because they were out of them?
Oh, sure.
I was like, what is
that
happening?
Sounds right. I mean, there's people are getting
the lines. The line are like,
time to get one of these.
The lines are insane.
Oh, let's go get one.
Popeye's. I drove past it and I was like, oh, maybe I'll get one. I've heard they're like out at some of them, so I wasn't like too sure, like maybe if it's open, but the line was like out the door, and I'm like, oh, okay, well, I guess I'm just going somewhere else.
Yeah, that's crazy.
I mean, like 2 weeks ago, I was listening to NPR like reviewing it and saying why it was like better than everywhere else.
It's the whole big chicken time.
It just sounds so good.
I've even had Chick-fil-A like regularly. There is one like sort of close to us. I just don't go to it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't believe in their policies.
Yeah. What do you mean?
the owner's beliefs.
Oh, they closed on Sundays? Is that what you're
talking about? Yeah, I'm hungry on Sunday. What am I supposed to do? Go to McDonald's?
Very rude of them. Very rude.
And it's no other reason.
Yeah, meanwhile, we can go over to the KFC and get that chicken sandwich where it's like literal chicken breast instead of bread or whatever.
Oh, the double down?
The double down,
that
that's right.
Bad.
It seems like.
No. They've been pushing that for years.
I get the Wendy's spicy chicken.
Even I couldn't get to it. I do like the Wendy's spicy chicken.
That's the only like chicken sandwich. But maybe it's Popeye's ones.
I remember, I think,
deal.
Was there ever a fast food item that like left a menu and you
there
actually
used to
sad
be
about?
There's a couple things.
I never had the McRib. So I don't know what that was like.
Wendy's used to have Caesar wraps, and they were so good.
Interesting. Wait, I feel like I remember
those. They were on like a pita bread that was like fluffy and airy, and it was just like chucked full of chicken and lettuce and Caesar dressing, and it was delicious.
Oh, man.
Taco Bell also had like a Caesar taco of some kind, and that was great, too. I just like a Caesar fast food item.
Yeah.
That's what it's boiling down to.
Yeah. Nothing beats a Caesar salad.
Oh, I love a Caesar salad, but if it's in a wrap... Or
forget
in a taco?
It. Forget about it.
Come on.
Wrap it up.
Get out of here.
Get out of town.
Get out of here. People liked the Big and Tasty or the McRib. Yeah, those are the big McDonald's ones.
Okay, does the Big and Tasty still exist?
In Canada.
Okay. Because when he said that in the movie, I was like, oh, I remember that. But
Yeah, that's
it's
gone.
Gone.
It's gone.
I don't think I've ever had like a McRib or anything. Trying to think.
The hula burger?
I got
to grab that.
Ooh, this is a piece of pineapple.
Yeah, it's disgusting. The dumbest idea possible.
I got sad. Burger King, they have their chicken tender crisp sandwich. They had like the spicy chicken tender crisp, which was just the same sandwich, but with like they had the spicy sauce they put on it. And at some point, they axed it.
I've never liked a Burger King thing.
I was so upset when they got rid of that because I loved it. And then they came back and they're like, now we have the new spicy chicken sandwich. And it's just, it's spicy breading now. And I'm like, it's not the same. You guys, you let me down. You know, you really hurt me.
There's a couple items coming off the Taco Bell menu that are a big deal. Mm. They're getting rid of the double decker.
Are you fucking kidding me?
I am not.
That was one thing I got.
And they're getting rid of the Cool Ranch Doritos taco, I think.
Oh, okay.
But I don't care about that.
Double-decker taco?
Yeah.
You mean I can't even get the double-decker taco supreme?
I remember when Shaq was selling that to me in 1997.
Yeah. Oh, wow. It's old.
It was a Godzilla Chihuahua tie-in, I'm pretty sure.
Well, don't they have like the triple taco now?
Triple taco? No,
no. I just made that up.
Are you drunk?
They went from the 2 to the 3.
Quadruple stack?
You say that like, and I would laugh, but it's... I wouldn't be surprised.
I'm going to go to Taco Bell and ask them to make me a three taco, just all stacked together.
You can do that.
I'm going to.
You can make it happen.
I'm going
to
make it a menu item.
Did you see the Little Caesars Quattro? You see commercials for that thing?
What?
It's 4 different kinds of meat pizza in one pizza. You get 2 slices of pepperoni, 2 slices of bacon, 2 slices of sausage, and like 2 slices of like olive.
So it's like when you go to those pizza buffets and they have those hodgepodge pizzas, but now you're actually just bringing it home.
Mm-hmm.
See, I'm not a meat person on pizza.
Ooh, me neither.
I do not like it.
I'll take a bacon, but I'll leave a bacon too.
Give me a bacon. I'll take a bacon, pepperoni.
Bacon is like
Italian
one of the
sausage.
Ones that I absolutely don't want.
Sausage sometimes.
Ham is like the only thing I don't want on a pizza.
Ham's a little gross.
I don't like ham on pizza.
I feel like there's a way to do ham correctly, and they just don't do it. They just put that big slab on
there. And I get upset too, because I also like pineapple on pizza, so that's a hot take. But I hate Hawaiian pizzas because the ham is on there and I don't want it. Get it out of there. Just give me a straight up pineapple pizza.
And the problem is too, when you say like I like pineapple on pizza, people automatically assume, okay, we're gonna get ham too on there.
Yeah,
like,
you're like,
don't,
oh well,
the
get please the don't Hawaiian. Do that. And I'm like, no, I didn't say I like pineapple and ham on a pizza. Yeah. I said I like pineapple on a pizza. Get out of here.
Pineapple and jalapeno, though.
Tell us how you really feel,
guys. Do we have time for this? Because we're about to get into it.
It's about to pop off.
You never really eat a lot of fast food. Did you have any favorites growing up?
Oh, I did eat a lot of fast food.
Oh.
Yeah.
Do you have any items?
Mostly
you can't
Taco
have
Bell
anymore?
Items, though, is what I go for.
So you were a big Taco Bell guy in your younger days?
Still?
You can't kick the habit.
No.
Got to get that Baja Blasted.
The one thing I always get, without fail, every time I go to Taco Bell, I will grab at least one or two of the spicy potato soft tacos because they're so freaking good.
They're tasty.
It's weird. I almost never eat Taco Bell for lunch anymore, but I will go there for breakfast because the breakfast Crunchwraps,
it's not bad,
are delicious.
Oh yeah,
they're
delicious
cheap too.
Yeah, they're cheap and they're like the little tiny handheld ones. Like they're not the same size as like the regular Crunchwraps. They're like smaller.
That's what they triple dip.
Easy
the
and
Crunchwrap.
Just yum, yum, yum. Like that's an easy breakfast that I can eat in the car.
Yeah,
because they're
the taco
made for
breakfast
the car.
Is very nice.
I mean anything. Oh my gosh, breakfast tacos are like my favorite. The food in the world. I would eat it for every meal.
Yeah, I will say I had some of the Crunchwrap breakfast sandwiches, and they are
they're
quite
fine.
Nice.
They're
like
a fine sandwich.
The jalapeno cream or whatever is what it's called, the sauce they put on the breakfast Crunchwraps is delicious. I love it, and I want it on everything else.
Do you get, like, coffee with it in the morning?
No.
I feel like they don't have, like, the drink, the morning drink figured out yet quite.
That's true. I never get a drink with it.
They need, like, an iced coffee or, like, a something. Like a Mexican hot chocolate or Mexican iced coffee or something.
I will say one thing that McDonald's does not know how to do is make iced coffee.
It's gross. It's so sugary.
It is awful. It doesn't even look like coffee anymore.
No. Man, it's very bright white.
I don't think I've ever...
Exactly.
I don't think I've ever liked or wanted a coffee from like any fast food place. Dunkin' Donuts is the only place I would get a coffee from.
Yeah, those are okay.
Everywhere else I would like, give me an orange juice. Give me something else. I don't want...
I will argue that the McDonald's coffee, just a black coffee, is actually pretty good.
It's only
$1
it's been so long since I've tried
all sizes.
I've never actually tried it, I don't think so. Yeah. I just wrote them off. Maybe it's worth a try.
It's very hot.
That's what I've heard.
It's good.
They tell you it's hot, though.
That
the
was
lady
its,
got
I mean, yeah,
hot.
I would say that was its own lawsuit, too.
Mm-hmm.
But she got burned.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. She got
Did
seriously
you
burned.
Did you see the photo?
Yeah. No, like
people. McDonald's like swept
it,
that under
it
the rug.
It looked horrible.
People hold that case up as like a like
the coffee
the
was,
lawsuit's
it was
gone
too
mad,
hot.
And I'm like, no, that was clearly a.
She was like
a
70-year-old
problem.
Woman
that,
too. It felt
that coffee was kept like way hotter than it should have been.
Yep.
And yeah, that was a serious problem. Like she got
she
seriously.
She probably shouldn't
hammed.
Have put it between her lap though.
Yeah,
that was
blame the victim. Blame the victim.
I said I felt bad for her, and I said it was horrible.
But there needs to be a breakfast drink.
Breakfast drink.
Someone needs to crack this code. Yeah. It's not out there yet. It's somewhere lingering.
It's called a Bloody Mary, Brad.
If they start serving those, that'd be pretty sweet. If I can get like a...
Get one of those Taco Bell cantinas for breakfast, you know? They have the bars inside.
The Bloody Mary would be perfect for them.
Get a virgin mimosa somehow. I don't know how you're going to do it, but make it happen. Give me a sparkling orange juice.
I usually just get a regular orange juice if I'm going, because that's...
Sparkle that up.
Give me those vitamins, you know?
Oh, no.
Oh, he's crying remembering that Big Mac he ate.
Did you get a little... I got a little sesame seed. We were on the same wavelength.
I was trying to get other things on the thing, but could have been everything.
I don't know. It's still in my eye. I don't have much more to say.
No, yeah. I mean, we were rambling about food. It was great.
Yeah.
It was good.
The documentary brings up conversations.
Can we do another documentary?
Yeah, see, this is the whole point of a documentary is to create a conversation.
I don't know if there's any that got as big as this one.
I bet we could find them.
Like March of the Penguins was the one that
The Michael Moore ones are always a big
but
to
those
do.
Aren't great.
No,
really? They're sad. They're more sad.
Yes,
and depressing.
They're heavy and sad and depressing, which is the point. But I think I would say like those are more well known, I think, than any other kind of big release documentary.
They had Mr. Rogers one though.
Yeah,
real big. Thank you for joining us on that episode and every episode. The next movie we're doing has the tagline, "Nature called, look who answered." We remember Big Daddy.
New York, if you want to enter the greatest city on earth, first, you have to get by one person.
Shut up! You shut up! Let's go! I'm waiting on you!
Sonny Koufax had an easy job.
You're a toll collector.
Where are you going? You want to take me with you?
I guess.
And led a simple life.
The delivery guy's like your best friend.
Come back later today. I'll Indian wrestle you.
Okay. Peace out.
Until the day...
You refuse to move on to the next phase of your life.
She wants different things, you know?
His girlfriend dumped him for someone else.
I found someone.
This old guy?
He has a 5-year plan.
What is it? Don't die?
Now, to win her back.
I gotta do something big with my life.
He's getting her a little surprise.
I want you to meet Julian, my son. Our son, I adopted him.
Great. Now what?
Now.
You wear a diaper?
No.
Sonny Koufax is finding out.
Should I have a nightlight?
Nightlight?
Once you adopt a kid.
There you go, all right?
You better give that kid back.
I tried to give him back.
You got to keep him.
Go back to sleep.
I wet my bed.
All right. Nice and dry.
No more wetness.
So let's go. You got the music in you.
Do that thing I talked to you the other day.
That one touched the ground. That one touched the ground.
Columbia Pictures presents...
We stopped serving breakfast at 10:30.
No!
Oh, please.
Don't cry. Don't cry.
You got a Happy Meal? Can we get a Happy Meal?
Who's coming to get you to a Happy Meal?
Adam Sandler.
It's gonna be fun. You nervous?
Happy Halloween. We got a first timer out here. Do the right thing, buddy.
Hang out right here for a second, all right?
Hey, you.
What?
Big Daddy.
That's it. Okay, yeah, that's good. Trick or treat. Next year, be prepared, moron.